Assalamu alaikum, this is Dr. Fatma. Today we are going to discuss invasive blood pressure monitoring. I have divided this particular topic into two videos. In this particular video, we are going to discuss the basics of invasive blood pressure monitoring. In the next video, we will just discuss the waveforms. Okay, what are the goals of today's discussion? We are going to discuss the introduction, advantages and disadvantages, components and principle of the blood pressure monitoring, accuracy of the invasive blood pressure monitoring, and setting up the arterial line and troubleshooting the problems. Also, we are going to discuss the complications which we can get from the arterial blood pressure monitoring. Starting with the introduction, well guys, invasive blood pressure monitoring is very commonly used technique in the intensive care unit as well as in the operating room in those patients who are sick and in those patients who have got long duration of surgery or long duration of monitoring. The technique involves the insertion of a catheter into the suitable artery and then displaying the measured blood pressure wave on the monitor. The most common reason for using intra-arterial blood pressure monitoring is basically a beat-to-beat record of the patient's blood pressure. What are its advantages? Well, as I said in the previous slide, that it is used for the continuous blood pressure monitoring, which we can get with every beat of pulse. So it's the best thing with arterial blood pressure monitoring. It gives you accurate reading of the blood pressure as compared to the other modes of blood pressure monitoring. Arterial blood pressure monitoring is the best sort of monitoring as far as accuracy of your reading is concerned. Well, trauma from the blood pressure cuff is avoided if you pass an arterial line, because you don't have to inflate the cuff again and again if your patient has got an invasive arterial line. Intravascular volume status monitoring can be done with invasive blood pressure monitoring waveform pattern. You can see the waveform on the monitor and you can interpret different results from those waveforms. And it can be used for arterial sampling, but it is not the sole objective of arterial, arterial line. To say that if you are going to pass an arterial line, you should not do it just to take the samples from the artery for ABGs or anything, but yes, it can be utilized for it once it has already been passed patient. It has got some disadvantages as well. The most important one is infection. The other thing is thrombosis. If you have got an arterial line and if it gets thrombosis in that artery, the blood supply to the limb can be damaged, and it can lead to even amputation of that limb. So be aware of this complication as well. Inadvertent administration of the drugs is also possible if some person who is new to arterial line and who doesn't know if it is an arterial line or an IV line, or even if a patient is not new, accidentally he can give drug through the arterial line, and it can lead to disastrous effects as well. Time consuming and difficult in shock patients, because they have got poor peripheral perfusion, and if a patient is in shock, you are unable to palpate the pulse, so you are going to waste time in passing an arterial line just to get the blood pressures. So please resuscitate the patient first and then go with an ultrasound and try again with an ultrasound. It's expensive, as in non-invasive blood pressure monitoring that is reusable. You can reuse a blood pressure cuff on different patients, but this is not a reusable thing. You have to discard it once you have done blood pressure monitoring on one patient, and the whole process is difficult. But you should see the risk versus benefit and then use an arterial line. And also, it needs an electrical supply source. So if you don't have a battery backup, you can have time when there is no blood pressure monitoring with the arterial line. Okay, so what are the indications of the blood pressure monitoring? Of course, in those patients in which you really need a real-time blood pressure monitoring, you are going to cannulate an artery for invasive blood pressure monitoring. Who are these patients? These are the patients who have got some surgery which can take greater than 1 to 2 hours, or in those patients who are really sick or who are really hemodynamically unstable, and in those patients in whom you are anticipating some hemodynamic variations more than usual, so you should cannulate their artery. Also, in the patients in whom you are anticipating some pharmacological or mechanical cardiovascular manipulation. For example, the patients in CCU or a patient in an intensive care unit, he has got a vasopressor or an inotropic support, you should not leave the patient without an arterial line. Also, in those patients in whom you need repeated blood pressure, blood sampling. For example, in those patients, for example, who are having serious respiratory complications, for example, patients with ARDS, patients with COPD, patients with asthma or status asthmaticus, or who are on ventilator, you need to have arterial blood gases every half an hour. So you should pass the arterial line in those particular patients. In those patients, for example, who are obese, who are super obese, or who have got edema in their limb, and you are unable to do an indirect blood pressure monitoring. For example, in the previous video, I have discussed in detail that you need an appropriate cuff size for blood pressure monitoring. The cuff sizes are different, and you need to see which cuff size is appropriate for your patient. If the cuff size of non-invasive blood pressure monitoring device is not appropriate, you are going to get erroneous readings. So if the appropriate size cuff is not available, you should go and directly cannulate the artery of the patient. Also, supplementary diagnostic information from the arterial waveform, whenever it is required, you should pass an arterial line. Now we are going to discuss the components and principle of arterial blood pressure monitoring, which have been divided into three further components: measuring apparatus, transducer, and monitor. This is a measuring apparatus, or the whole system of an arterial line. You can see this patient who has got a radial artery cannulated with an arterial line, which is directed with the transducer, and also it is directed towards a processor and then a display system which is on monitor. Also, you can see the pressurized saline bottle. The one thing you should see that the transducer is at the site, at the level of patient's heart. So this is the key point in arterial waveform, arterial blood pressure monitoring, that you have to place the transducer according to the position of the patient's heart. If the patient is propped up, you have to again switch the transducer's place according to the uplift of the patient's heart or patient's position. So what is the measuring apparatus? Well, we need an arterial cannula, a 20 gauge cannula for adults, and a 22 gauge cannula in the children. We need a tubing which should be non-compliant. What is non-compliant tubing? This is resistant, you cannot bend it. So a tubing which is containing a column of normal saline. You need a flushing system which consists of a 500 ml of bag of normal saline, which is pressurized with a pressure infuser to 300 mm of mercury via a flushing device. You need stopcocks. You need inline blood sampling ports, a transducer, and electronic cable. This is the arterial line which we use in our setup. You can see the needle on the superior end of this picture. And then we have got a guide wire which I am going to pass from the needle above. And when I have passed the transducer, I have passed the guide wire through the needle, I will remove the needle. And then the third thing which you can see is the green and red thing, that is basically the arterial line which you are going to railroad on the guide wire. So this is done via the Seldinger technique. This is another setup for arterial cannulation. You can see an antiseptic solution. You need a local anesthetic. For example, if a patient is awake and oriented, you should not pass an arterial line without a local anesthetic because it's a painful procedure. Also, you need a syringe. You need dressing sponges. You can see we need electronic transducer and cable, the pressure transducer and tubing. We need an arm board to rest the patient's arm. You can see we need intravenous catheter, the guide wire which I have mentioned in the previous slide, and the Arrow arterial catheterization kit. This is another picture in which you can see on the left side a fluid filled tubing, and this fluid filled tubing also in you can see the red tinge. It can be blood or it can be, you know, a red label on the tubing, so that one cannot use it for giving the any drug through the ports. Okay, so most of the modern invasive arterial blood pressure measuring systems have got this red labeling. The other way, you can see the three-way tap, flushing system, pressure transducer, and on the other side you can see a pressurized saline tubing. Also you can see the cable to the signal processor. Now we are going to discuss the transducer. Well, we know what is a transducer. A transducer is any device which converts one form of the energy to another form of the energy. Your larynx, for example, it's a transducer as well, because when you speak, what happens is that you have air movement in your larynx. So the air movement energy is converted into the sound energy by your larynx. So it's a transducer as well. In an arterial line, the transducer is a flexible diaphragm on which when a pressure is applied, it stretches and the resistance changes and is displayed on the monitor screen. Well, what does it use? It uses a circuit which is called as Wheatstone bridge. This Wheatstone bridge you have to learn by heart, because this is frequently asked in many OSCE exams whenever there is an arterial line in the OSCE. And it should be calibrated to the atmospheric pressure. Okay, so this is the Wheatstone bridge, guys. In this Wheatstone bridge, you can see you have got four resistors, three with the known resistance and the Rx is with unknown resistance. You can see a galvanometer in the center, and on the left side, you can see the positive and the negative ends of the rods. The monitor. The monitor is the display system and analytic system of the arterial line system. So what does it tell you? It displays the systolic, the diastolic, and the mean arterial pressure on the screen. It displays the waveform as well, and it cancels the noise. Most of the new monitors, they also cancel the noise. You see a beat-to-beat monitoring in on the screen. Also, it has got some safety features. For example, you set a proper lower limit of the blood pressure and an upper limit of the blood pressure. And whenever your blood pressure is critically low or critically high, you will hear an alarm and then you can troubleshoot accordingly. This is a classical picture of the modern cardiac monitor. In the top panel, you can see the arterial pressure waveform. Usually when we have got the cardiac monitor and we have got different functions in it, we give red color to the arterial pressure waveform. In the lower panel, in the next left side, you can see the systolic, the diastolic, as well as the mean arterial pressure, the pulse. And on the right side, you can also see cardiac output, stroke volume, pulse pressure variation, and systemic vascular resistance. Now, the accuracy of invasive blood pressure monitoring. Well, I need to know that how my arterial blood pressure monitoring device is working. For knowing this, I need to know all these four points, which is oscillation, natural frequency, resonance, and damping. Before going into detail of these four things, I need to tell you that these are very important but easy things. Usually when we read this particular topic from our books, we just leave these four things because we don't understand them, because they are not written in very easy language. So today we are going to discuss them in an easy language so that all of us know what these are and how we have to troubleshoot our arterial blood pressure monitoring system. Starting with the oscillations. A swinging pendulum is a classical example of an oscillating system. In the right side of the screen, you can see a pendulum. What happens is that when it is pushed from one end, it starts oscillating from the point of rest till its maximum height, which is called as amplitude. And it comes back to the set point. But when it comes to the set point with gravity, it continues to move in the other direction unless the heat energy dissipates. And it continues to move forward and backward. This forward and backward, I mean to and fro motion, is called as oscillation. You can also have an example of this swing which usually are used by the children. In this very example, you can see that the force which is applied by the baby or the child who is sitting on that swing is moving that pendulum to its maximum height, and it comes back to the gravity, and then it goes back from the set point. So this is the oscillation. The other thing we need to know is natural frequency. Well guys, every material which has got oscillation has a frequency at which it oscillates freely. This is called as natural frequency. For example, a pendulum of set length and a set width at the end will always oscillate at exactly the same frequency, no matter what the initial starting point of oscillation is. Even if you put maximum energy or minimum energy, the frequency is going to be same. I mean, the pendulum is, for example, if a pendulum has got 60 hertz energy, it's going to have 60 oscillations per minute, even if you apply the maximum energy or even if you apply the minimum energy, but the frequency will remain same. This is called as natural frequency. What is resonance? Well, natural frequency and resonance are interrelated. If a, similar to a natural frequency is applied, if a force which is similar to the natural frequency is applied to the system, it will begin to oscillate at the maximum amplitude, or I mean overshoot. This is called as resonance. Take an example. For example, what happens is that in arterial line monitoring, if the resonance occurs, the amplitude will be higher than the original amplitude, and it is going to give you an erroneously high blood pressure when the resonance is there. If you don't understand it, let me just revise it for you. In the natural frequency, you can see that the pendulum is oscillating at a particular frequency with a particular amplitude, which is also dissipating with the time. But the resonance is basically a force which has got similar natural frequency. And if that force is applied to that pendulum thing, what is going to happen? The pendulum's oscillation amplitude is going to be larger than before. Okay, so when an arterial line is used and when there is a resonance in arterial line system, your blood pressure is going to be erroneously high, even if it is not. So to tackle this problem, what we do is that natural frequency of an A-line system is 8 times higher than the pulse rate. For example, if a patient has got a heart rate of 180, the natural frequency of the arterial line should be at least 8 into 180, okay, just to minimize the resonance. How can we minimize the resonance? We can reduce the length of the cannula or the tubing. We can reduce the compliance of the cannula or the diaphragm. We can reduce the density of the fluid which is used in the tubing. And also, we can increase the diameter of the cannula or the tubing. Damping. This is very important thing. What is damping? Well, anything which reduces the energy in an oscillating system is going to decrease the amplitude of the oscillation. The best example for damping is a rusted pendulum. When you compare a rusted pendulum versus a greased pendulum or a new pendulum, you are going to see that the most of the energy of an oscillating system, of an oscillating pendulum, is going to, is going to be wasted in acting against the resistance which is being dealt with the rust, okay, on it. But if we use a greased or a new pendulum, it has got a good amplitude without a damping. What are the factors which lead to damping in an arterial system? Any friction, a three-way tap, clots or bubbles in the tubing. Well, if there is a in the tubing, or the narrow, long or compliant tubing, and vasospasm. Even if the artery is in the spasm, of course, there is going to be a damping because it's going to reduce the amplitude of the oscillation system. You can see this in this particular figure. On the left side of this figure, you can see a normal waveform of an artery. In the middle of the panel, you can see an overdamped system. What is happening? In here, you can see that in overdamped system, the amplitude is lower. So the systolic blood pressure, which was before around 140, is now around 120s or 110s, and the diastolic blood pressure, which was around 60s, is now showing to be around 100s. So what happens is that when an arterial line is overdamped, your systolic blood pressure is going to be erroneously low and diastolic blood pressure is going to be erroneously high. इन द अंडर डैम्प्ड सिस्टम व्हाट हैपेंस इज दैट योर सिस्टोलिक ब्लड प्रेशर इज गोइंग टू ओवरशूट एंड डायस्टोलिक प्रेशर इज गोइंग टू अंडरशूट. सो यू हैव गॉट अ पल्स प्रेशर विच इज वाइड एज कम्पेयर टू नॉर्मल थिंग. Now, setting up the arterial line and troubleshooting. Okay, first of all, we have to select a site. Radial artery cannulation. I mean to say that if you are going to select a site, you have to prefer radial artery. Why? Because it's the most common site because it is superficial. Okay, you can easily palpate it in most of the patients. The hand blood supply is not compromised. It is preserved usually because most of the hand is supplied by ulnar artery. You can check it via the Allen's test. What do we do in Allen's test? Well, an Allen's test is only applicable in the awake patient. What you do is that you just ask the, you just, you know, put your both thumbs of both hands, one on the ulnar artery and one on the radial artery, and press them both and ask the patient to, or ask the subject to, just make a fist. Okay, and you just keep the pressure there for a few seconds, and when the patient opens his fist, if the fist is white and there is no if the fist is white and there is no flow, you see that the artery which is supplying is the radial artery, and you should not pass the radial arterial line in that particular person. You can see this how we do it. We have got different techniques to cannulate a radial artery. You can do it via palpatory method, but in palpatory method, what you need, you have to fix, you have basically, first of all, you have to rest the arm on a armrest, then you have to put a small pillow or a small round soft object under the wrist and extend the hand, and then you have to fix the fingers with a tape or anything. Okay, and then you just cannulate it by a palpation. The other thing you can see is the ultrasound guidance. In ultrasound, you can see it in this picture. We are going in plane mode. You can also go in out of plane mode. Other sites of arterial cannulation are basically radial artery, which is a preferred site. There is ulnar artery as well. Complications similar to the radial artery, but primary source of hand blood supply. So please make it sure that you don't ruin the hand. Well, brachial artery, as far as the brachial artery is concerned, you should try not to cannulate a brachial artery unless it is absolutely desirable. Why? Because it is the end artery and it is supplying the whole arm. If you just make a thrombus in it, you are going to lose the patient's arm. Axillary artery is also a frequent site, femoral artery and dorsalis pedis artery. As far as femoral artery is concerned, my dear friends, you need to know that femoral artery is also an end artery, but it is having a wide bore, it is having a wide width, as well as it has got a more blood flow. So even if you cannulate it, the formation of thrombus is, I mean, less likely as compared to brachial artery. So you can utilize the femoral artery as well. Practical tips and troubleshooting. We are just going to end and finish this video soon. Well, not finding the artery, so well, it's too superficial that you might have already crossed it. So please relax, remove the needle, slowly withdraw the cannula, and once it is in the artery, blood will pop out. You can also, you know, place a syringe behind your needle so that you just don't, I mean, spill the blood over everywhere. Hit the artery but failed to cannulate. So what to do? Change the site. Why? Because when you do cannulate an artery once or twice or even thrice, what happens is that it is got traumatized and the artery goes in spasm. So please change your site, go to the other wrist. If you cannot pass an A-line in a patient with shock, what should you do? I have discussed this particular thing in the previous slides as well. It's okay, do not waste time. Resuscitate the patient and attempt with an ultrasound guidance, and don't be hurried about that arterial line, because the most important thing in a shock patient is to resuscitate him and make him hemodynamically stable. A sudden very high or very low reading, just check the transducer side as compared to heart. Waveform suddenly became flat. So what will happen? Check the pulse. If the pulse is palpable, okay, that's okay. I mean, your patient is fine. But now find the cause of damping and just correct it. Over damping or under damping, well, both of these conditions will affect the blood pressure reading. Over damping, systolic pressure will be low, diastolic pressure will be high, and you have got a narrow pulse pressure. In under damping, systolic pressure will be high and diastolic pressure will be low, so you are going to get a wide pulse pressure. Last thing is zeroing and leveling. You most of the time see that we zero the arterial line and we level it off. What is zeroing? Basically, for an invasive blood pressure system to optimally work, atmospheric pressure should be discounted from the measurement of the arterial pressure. So it is done by exposing the transducer to the atmospheric pressure and calibrating the pressure reading to zero from the monitor. What is leveling? Transducer should be placed at the level of patient's heart in mid-axillary line at 4th intercostal space in any position, in supine position, prone position, or in a head position, head up position. Okay. Transducer too low will overread, and transducer which is too high will underread the blood pressure. These are the complications. You can see on the left side upper panel, the patient has got distal ischemia because of thrombosis. Well, it can get a pseudo aneurysm if you have got multiple times break the artery. You can have arteriovenous fistula, hemorrhage, arterial embolization, infection, peripheral neuropathy, and misinterpretation of the data. I mean, if somebody is not aware of arterial line, he can misinterpret the data and give wrong drugs to the patient. It can be misused. I mean, for example, in accidental drug administration via the arterial line. Thank you very much. I hope you like this video. Please subscribe the channel and like it. And don't forget to watch the non-invasive blood pressure monitoring. In the next video, we are going to discuss the waveforms of invasive blood pressure monitoring. Till then, Allah Hafiz. Thank you.